The discovery that leaky gut contributes to celiac disease and autoimmunity, when first introduced, was treated with great skepticism. 5 years after the formulation of that hypothesis, Dr. Alessio Fasano and his team discovered Zonulin, a protein that reversibly modulates intestinal permeability. Zonulin's effect on gut permeability involves the regulation of tight junctions in intestinal and extra-intestinal cells, including the endothelial cells of the blood-brain barrier. So why should you care? Well, it's because it plays an important role in gut permeability, otherwise known as leaky gut syndrome. And it turns out there are several potential intestinal stimuli that can trigger Zonulin's release. One is bacterial dysbiosis, and the other is gluten. The discovery that Zonulin causes aberrant intestinal permeability led to the appreciation that this protein is involved in the pathogenesis of a variety of autoimmune diseases, including type 1 diabetes, multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, and inflammatory bowel disease. We invited Dr. Alessio Fasano to join us for a conversation that matters about our guts, our microbiome, and what we can do to manage our well-being through diet and lifestyle.
Conversations That Matter is a partner program of the Center for Dialogue at Simon Fraser University. The production of this program is made possible thanks to the following and viewers like you. Please become a patron at conversationsthatmatter.tv.
You've done a tremendous amount of research in the state of our diet and the way that it is affecting us. Can you give me a quick little state of the nation? How are we doing?
Not well.
Not well.
No. Mainly because we radically changed our lifestyle, including, you know, the way that we eat in a recent past, and we pay consequences.
It's the quality of the food, isn't it?
It is definitely more the quality than the quantity. You know, it's not much the genetic engineered grains. Is the amount of gluten in a food that is not just the natural source, like to eat, you know, bread, pasta, and pizza. Of course, you have, you know, gluten in there. But in the food industry, you know, gluten has been used now for quite a while as a filler. So the overall amount of gluten that we're exposed is much higher than before. What was our contribution is, you know, how gluten will lead to an autoimmune disease.
Yes.
The link between gluten and celiac disease was made, you know, almost 70 years ago. But the mechanism underlining, you know, this chain of events that it leads to this insult of the gut that characterized celiac disease with all the clinical consequences, it's something that we had, you know, a general idea, but, you know, lately, because of many studies coming from our group and then, you know, supported by others, we now have better idea of funding blocks, how you march from eating gluten and not having problems to eating gluten and develop celiac disease if you're genetically predisposed.
So what is that path, that journey?
Well, the journey, it's as typically happen, you spill from physiology to, in other words, to have, you know, normal, healthy, you know, relationship with food like gluten to the problem in which, you know, for reasons that now we start to understand, exposure to gluten that, by the way, is a mixture of proteins that we cannot completely digest because we lack the enzymes to, you know, break this in the funding blocks. So if you allow me the comparison, gluten can be considered like a pearl necklace, and like any protein needs to be broken in pieces that we call peptides, and then you peel these pearls one at a time. They're an amino acid that we can then eventually absorb for our own use. We can do this with any protein by gluten. So these undigested fragments, they are perceived as enemy by immune system that, you know, trigger this immune response that, again, on a specific genetic background, you develop celiac disease.
Got to get you to hang on for a second while we take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back. Conversations That Matter is brought to you by Odlum Brown, a client-focused investment firm that starts client relationships with straightforward conversations focused on you, your aspirations, and your investment priorities. Odlum Brown has been a supporter of Conversations That Matter from the day we started this show. Their only condition was that we provide a non-biased conversation with people from all sides of all sorts of issues. And of course, we couldn't produce this show without the support of Oh Boy Productions. If you're looking to produce a show like this one, I suggest you reach out to Oh Boy. They can help you produce it, and they can help you build your audience. And we also need your support. I ask you to please pledge $1 per show by going to conversationsthatmatter.tv/donate, because those dollars add up and play an important role in helping us produce this show. Now, back to the show. What happens when they are identified as enemies, and what are the consequences of that?
So, you know, when these fragments, they are undigested, they sit into the GI tract. They do many things. One, makes the intestine leakier so that they can gain access in our body. And two, eventually they are now seen by the immune system coming in our body, and the immune system is there to defend us and fight. When you fight, you have, you know, collateral damage that is inflammation. Now, the amount of inflammation that you mount and the direction that it takes really depends on if the genes that make us predisposed to the celiac disease are put in motion. And my microbiome seems to be the culprit to switch from genetic predisposition to clinical outcome.
Okay, but you talk about somebody being predisposed to celiac disease. Would not the overconsumption of gluten then increase the likelihood that you would start to experience some of the symptoms that are associated with celiac disease? Because through epigenetics, is our genome not changing based on what we're consuming?
That's right, absolutely. You know, in the past, because we thought that, you know, celiac disease was the combination of genes that you're born with and environmental trigger being gluten, necessary, sufficient, we were under the impression that you develop the disease as soon as these two, you know, elements, they are, you know, contemporary, you know, present, meaning at the time in which baby food is introduced, because that's when, you know, gluten comes in the picture. And then we start to realize that people, they eat gluten for decades and they don't have a problem. And then eventually they develop the problem, you know, down the road. So for 40, 50 years, these people are able to eat gluten with no consequences, despite the two key elements that we thought that were sufficient to develop the problem are there. And then we learn that they are necessary but not sufficient. So these genes that are the crucial element there, they need to be put at play. And, you know, depending what you eat and therefore the composition and the function of the microbiome, these genes may be put at play by a different composition of the microbiome.
But it may not necessarily be something that you ingest. There's a fellow that I know who was in an incredibly stressful profession, and then when in his 50s, all of a sudden celiac disease presented itself. And he attributes it to the stress that he was under.
And he's absolutely right. And the reason why is because it's been described for ages that stressors like a surgery, like a pregnancy, like an infection, like a trip, or physical or emotional stress can put you over the edge. But we didn't understand why. Now we understand that most likely the common denominator, all these stressors, if you undergo to a surgery, if you take antibiotics, if you're physically and mentally stressed, it's changed the microbiome.
You talk about the gluten having this impact on the GI tract, creating a leakiness. What starts to happen when this goes on unabated? What are the health consequences to the individual?
The vast majority of people have no consequences. So to eat gluten, these fragments will make the intestine leakier through the release of molecule that we discovered a while ago called Zonulin. And if you're not genetically predisposed to have any problem, you know, your immune system cleaned the mess, so you don't even know that happened. There are those few in which that chain of events leads to the next step. So the immune system is not able to put, you know, a break to the chain of events. And, you know, depending who you're genetically speaking, some people, they may develop celiac disease. Some people, they may develop other chronic inflammatory diseases that can be put in motion by gluten.
Well, I was just at a talk for the Dr. Rogers Prize where you were speaking and you were talking about the dramatic increase in health-related issues that are directly linked to gluten. You then, in your talk, moved on and said, okay, now Zonulin. What exactly is Zonulin? What's the impact of that, especially in children?
So Zonulin is a molecule that regulates the permeability of the gut. So normally, the gut is it has this single layer of cells. It's the formal barrier that keep the bay enemies and prevent this continuous interchange between the environment and the host. That is the essence of certain that, you know, chain events that lead to inflammation. We want to modulate the gut permeability because there are some advantages to do that, but we don't want to have this leakiness all the time. Mm-hmm. So Zonulin is the molecule, so far the only physiologic modulator of permeability of the gut and other district. When it's produced in the right amount, it does, you know, a service to us. When it goes out of control, one being, again, excessive exposure to this fragment of gluten on a specific genetic background will create this continuous leakiness that, again, can be the beginning of the, you know, this pathway that leads to inflammation. It's been linked now to a variety of chronic inflammatory diseases, from metabolic disorders to autoimmunity, to cancer, to sepsis, to aging. So it looks like that this molecule, as a biomarker of gut permeability, has a lot to do with inflammation and its consequences.
That wasn't an insignificant list that you just gave right now. I mean, those are serious issues that we have to pay attention to.
Most definitely. I mean, you know, this, by the way, is the list of, you know, epidemics of conditions that we see in a population like ours that embrace a Western lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So, again, in the past few decades, we radically change our lifestyle to increase the chance that rather to, you know, have, you know, infections that were the main reason why we got sick and we died, they're now being resolved with the implementation of hygiene and the use of antibiotics and vaccination and so on and so forth. That's not the culprit anymore in our latitudes. Now are this chronic non-infective inflammatory diseases, they are really rampage in terms of epidemics and create major problems. And the common denominator there is the leakiness of the gut that's only mediated.
So how ironic is it that we address what were the most pressing issues with regards to our health only to introduce new ones, and they're ones that we consume?
You know, it is laughable, so to speak, but this is the consequence.
Except that it's not. That's the unfortunate
laughable,
thing.
Unfortunately, it's not, because, you know, again, we strive, of course, to try to find to live longer. And we achieved that goal, by the way. I don't want to be deceived. So, you know, imagine, you know, 2 million years ago, our average, you know, life expectancy was 15 years. 200 years ago, life expectancy was 40 years.
Yes.
So in a relatively short period of time, we doubled life expectancy. But the problem is that the quality of life went down.
Yes.
So it doesn't really help to live longer. But, you know, for part of the life to be on a wheelchair with tube in our nose and have, you know, people that need to assist us, the goal is really longer and an independent life, and as healthy as possible. And I don't think that we achieved that goal, and we need to make some radical changes in terms of lifestyle.
You have been so bold as to say that there is a link between autism and the overproduction of Zonulin, and your research has been backed up. This is alarming.
Very much so, because among all the epidemics that we have been witnesses, you know, lately, the ones with autism are really alarming, because, you know, we went from 1 in 5,000 in the mid-70s to 1 in 58. So we are talking something that really, it is, you know, worrisome. And again, with the male-female ratio 4 to 1, you know, one child, one boy out of four, the next generation would be lost to autism. So clearly, we're doing something tremendously wrong. So we have the moral obligation, first of all, to understand what we've been doing wrong, and secondly, make a remedy to stop this epidemic.
What is that remedy?
The challenge with this chronic inflammatory diseases is that, you know, we've been focused ourselves on the condition and not the, you know, person.
Mm-hmm.
These are final destination. How you got there can be very different from one individual to another. So
yes,
they all got to the same final point, but the path that they follow can be very different from one group of individuals versus another. So the challenge and the opportunity that we see in front of us is to try to stratify the population, so to find the subgroups, and try to find out how that subgroup reached their final destination so that we can have a remedy. For example, we know that 20% of kids with autism, they may eventually been got there because of gluten sensitivity. So a gluten-free diet and a casein-free diet can be a good remedy. Others may be that it's related to oxidative stress or, you know, infections or whatever else. But once again, common denominator, no matter what path they follow, dysbiosis, so an imbalance in the microbiome that consequently increase, you know, Zonulin production and therefore gut permeability. Mm-hmm. So now we start to have a target, and therefore we may have a way to trying to find the, you know, the solution to the problem. What is the challenge is that, unfortunately, we study the problem when it's already materialized, so the horse is out of the barn, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And in order to make sense, to understand how you develop, what is the march from the genetic predisposition to the autism outcome, you need to follow these kids from birth. And that's exactly what we're doing with the support of the European community.
Well, and also when we take a look at the health of the microbiome, it starts before you're even born, does it not?
Absolutely. You know, it really depends on mom's lifestyle, the environment that she's, you know, living in. And of course, the perinatal events, the way that the baby is born, a C-section versus vaginal delivery, if it's premature, with antibiotic exposure, the kind of feeding, breastfeeding versus bottle feeding, you know, all these elements.
Mom plays a very important role.
Absolutely, yeah. Totally. The father as well, not as as impactful as mom, but the father also.
He brings his genetic heritage with him.
Not only that, of course, that's a given, but also contributes to the establishment and engraftment of the microbiome probably even before birth.
How important is vaginal delivery in that long term?
The microbiome that we live with in a symbiotic relationship, it doesn't come as a chance. It's highly selected by the host. So there is a symbiotic, you know, relationship that has to be compatible between the host genome and the microbiome. So there is no such thing as the normal microbiome. Each of us, we have our own microbiome. And because the genetic really determined the ideal microbiome, it comes as a given that, you know, if we're genetically linked to our mothers, her microbiome is good for us. It's the one that we definitely want as an engraftment.
She brought us into this world.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, when you're born by C-section, you take the skin microbiome of mom. That's not selected. It's all comers. You know, the operating, you know, personnel in the delivery room, microbiome, the anesthesiologist, the gynecologist, microbiome comes on that skin. And therefore, it's a mix of bugs that may not be compatible with the baby.
And what about breastfeeding?
This was done by design of evolution. The breastfeeding brings into the picture its own microbiome. So there is a milk microbiome that, you know, supplements the ones that you receive during, you know, delivery for first engraftment. Then there are immunoglobulins that really help to code some of the microbiome that will make this relationship to be ideal. And last not least, there are what we call prebiotics. So in other words, food for the microbiome that is necessary to flourish the part of the microbiome that you want there. Okay. And for example, human monoglycosaccharides that, you know, for decades have been an headache for scientists because we didn't know what they was doing there since the baby cannot make use of it. And again, this doesn't come by chance. It was a try and retry of human evolution during the 2 million years that brought us where we are. So in other words, all the steps have been designed for 2 million years to get the perfect, you know, combination between us and the microbiome.
Tested by and created by Mother Nature.
Absolutely.
And here we now then, we bring this beautiful child into the world. And in a Western lifestyle that we have right now, we may be setting them up for a quick deterioration of that perfect system that they can be blessed with. If we don't pay attention to their lifestyle, what does that lifestyle have to look like?
If you go back, you know, no more than 3 generations ago, you have the answer right there. You know, we don't have antibiotics yet. So I'm not demonizing the antibiotics. They play a major role.
Yeah, yeah.
But imagine that 95% of infections the first 2 years of life are viral and therefore would not benefit from antibiotic treatment. And yet we pediatricians, I say we because I'm a pediatrician as well, we are very prone to give antibiotics during that period of time as soon as the kid has fever for a couple of days and doesn't go away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we feed babies the way they were not used to. So beside the breastfeeding that has so many advantages, of course, it's sterile, it's the right temperature, it's produced at the right time and all 9 yards compared to bottle feeding. You know, when we start with baby food now, you know, moms that they work, and again, I don't want to demonize that as well, they don't have the time to prepare the food for the baby. So you buy the jar and God knows what is in there. You have to trust the food makers that they choose the best of the best for the child. Typically, it's not the case. And then, you know, of course, we go through, you know, the modern lifestyle of the fast food, the junk food that, you know, even in the cafeteria schools have been served until the recent past as, you know, the way to go. That is feeding only part of the microbiome, putting disadvantage other parts because, you know, the diversity of the microbiome required the diversity of nutrients that we were used to, evolutionarily speaking, to be exposed to. And we don't have that anymore. And finally, if you allow me to, another radical change is that, you know, there is no seasonality of the nutrients anymore. The, you know, the kilometer zero production is not, you know, something that's only few people can afford economically because now there is mass production and we want, you know, food all the way around, all year round, at the same level. You know, I was making the example today. You know, when I was growing up, we went for strawberries, you wait July and August, mm-hmm. and they look ugly. They look at different forms, but they were tasty. Now they're all big, they're all red, and you got this for 12 months a year. You wonder, you know,
what's the nutritional value of this?
That's right.
Let's fast forward to I'm 60 years of age, and I'm now starting to see the consequences of this modern Western lifestyle. What do I do?
Try to regain the lifestyle that we evolved with. So it starts with having good rest, sleep well, maintaining the circadian rhythm, eat well. Try to not be too stressed out. So take your life not too seriously, considering that there is an a beginning of an end. People, they don't believe that there is an end, so we're invincible and we really focus on stuff that, you know, the big scheme are trivial. And while other things that is important, like our own health, is not taken very seriously. And again, trying to really enjoy life, you know, in its essence, you know, value friendship, value family. This is all, you know, going back to your friend that developed celiac disease after major stress, these are all breaks on stress because these are all, you know, mitigators of the stressful life that we live now.
And cook your own meals.
And definitely cook your own meals.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Fabulous.
All right.
Yeah.